I'm Ushma Neal with the Journal of Clinical Investigation, here today with another in our series of conversations with giants in medicine. Today we're joined by Dr. Tadataka Tachi Yamada. Born in Japan but trained in the United States as a gastroenterologist, he quickly rose to be the chairman of the Department of Internal Medicine and physician-in-chief of the University of Michigan Medical Center. He moved on to eventually become the chairman of research and development for GlaxoSmithKline. In the next step in his interesting career, he moved from GSK to be the president of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation Global Health Program. In this capacity, he oversaw over $9 billion in programs directed at addressing the challenges of the developing world, including TB, HIV, and malaria. In 2011, Dr. Yamada moved on to become the chief medical and scientific officer and executive vice president of Takeda Pharmaceuticals. Thank you for joining us today. I think our readers and viewers will be interested by your different path through medicine. Can you tell me a little bit about how you got your start in medicine and what your path was to get to medical school?
Well, I actually, my grandfather was a physician. He died before I was born, but my mother would often talk about him and talk about the profession as a very special profession. So I grew up wanting to be a physician, and I spent, for my third birthday, I asked for a stethoscope, and I got one, so I played doctor from there on. But at one point in college, I got more interested in history and philosophy, and I was actually scheduled to go to graduate school with a Woodrow Wilson fellowship. But it was the time of the Vietnam War. If you went to medical school, you actually were deferred from military service. As it turns out, I actually went into the military after I'd gotten my degree and had been a resident. But I got into medicine because I wanted to be in medicine, then for a while I didn't, but then I found myself in medical school in New York City, and that's how I became a physician.
Now, did you do any scientific research during medical school, or did that training come afterwards?
Well, actually, because I was a history major in college, I was not trained in science like many of the medical students were when I went to medical school. But when I got to medical school, and the first 2 years were all about science, I was way behind. I really didn't understand it, know about it, or care about it. But it was really when I went on the ward services as a third-year clerk that I realized that you had to be a good scientist if you were going to be a good doctor. And that's what sort of transformed my interest in medicine and in research and science. And in my fourth year in medical school, I actually spent a good part of my elective time working in a laboratory.
Whose laboratory was that?
It was a pulmonary physician at NYU named Roberta Goldring.
Now, so your early start was in the pulmonary field, but you made your mark scientifically within gastroenterology.
Yes. Well, I hadn't really, I wasn't quite sure I was going to pursue a career in research. And when it came time for residency, I picked a residency that was close to my wife's family, which was in Richmond, Virginia. I went to the Medical College of Virginia for my residency. And as it turned out, they had a great, strong GI division there. And those people really got me very excited about gastroenterology. And I decided to become a gastroenterologist. In the meantime, I had to take a detour into the military because I was a Barry Plan officer. I spent 3 years at the U.S. Army Medical Research Institute of Infectious Diseases in Fort Detrick, Maryland, and I did research there. And it was great because there they gave me a lab and a technician and some money and said, do research. And I wasn't quite sure how to do it, but it was amazing because I spent time at the NIH, learned some protein chemistry, got involved in a project that was fun. I was trying to understand the role of the bradykinin system in in septic shock, and that got me interested in small peptide molecules. And amazingly enough, because the military set you up this way, either became a very independent investigator right away, or you just didn't become an investigator. And so by the time I'd finished the Army, I had maybe 7 papers or something, but I didn't have a mentor. I hadn't worked in anybody's lab. I just had to sort of create my own lab and do research.
What was your path from there to the University of Michigan?
Well, after I finished, I went to UCLA for a fellowship in gastroenterology. There was one of the fathers of modern gastroenterology, Morton Grossman, was there. And I wanted to train with him, and he was interested in peptide hormones that altered gut function. So I went there to do my fellowship, and I was very fortunate because in those days it was possible to get grants early. So by the time I finished my fellowship, I had a VA Career Development Award and an R01 grant from the NIH. And that set me on a path. A couple of years later, Bill Kelly from the University of Michigan was looking for a chief of gastroenterology at the University of Michigan's VA hospital. I wasn't really going to go look, but my mentor, Martin Grossman, at that time said, you've got to go. You've got to take a look and see what it's all about. I went there. I liked Michigan. I liked Bill Kelly, but I didn't like the job they were recruiting for, so I turned Bill down. And
you're one of the few.
Well, he came back to me. He said, you're the person I want in gastroenterology. Now, you got to understand, I was only a year and a half out of my fellowship when Bill started to recruit me. I mean, I don't know how Bill did it, but he identified people very early in their careers. And I just felt at that time I wasn't ready. He told me something that I'll never forget. He said, you're the person I want in gastroenterology, so you tell me when you're ready. And I'll keep the job open for you.
So how long did it take you to be ready?
It was about another year and a half. And I was actually looking at another position at another institution. And I sort of made a decision that I was going to go there. But after I'd made the decision to go, my wife actually wanted to leave Los Angeles where we were. I felt depressed about the decision, so I called Bill up and I said, Bill, you still have that job open for me? And he said, yeah. He said, did you make any commitments anywhere? I said, well, I kind of said I would go. And he said, did you sign anything? I said, no. He said, well, come to Michigan. And so that's how I got to Michigan.
And how long were you there? I know you rose to be chairman of maternal medicine and physician-in-chief for the entire medical school.
Right. I was there for 13 years. I was the chief of gastroenterology for 7 years, and I was the chairman of medicine for 6 years.
And during that experience, did you always have your eye on an eventual career in industry?
I had no idea I was going to go into industry. I enjoyed being a chief of gastroenterology. I actually think a division chief in medicine is the best job there is in an academic medical center. You have a good group, you can build a group, you can recruit good people, you're active in the lab, you're having fun. And I became the chairman of medicine after Bill left. I looked at other places, but in the end I thought if I left Michigan, I wouldn't be able to continue my research. Because if you're chairman of medicine, you're busy, and if you got to set up your lab all over again, I thought it would be very difficult. So I stayed at Michigan, and I was able to keep my lab going, and I was very involved in both the research and the teaching. And at that time, and probably still today, if you're chairman of medicine and you're doing okay, then other people are going to come and talk to you about being a, a dean or a vice president somewhere. I looked at a few of those jobs and I thought, you know, I don't think I want to do that. It just seemed, you know, at that time, there were a lot of Pac-Man wars of hospitals eating each other up and lots of politics, and I still liked the science and the medicine.
So then what changed to make you consider the job at SmithKline Beecham and then later GlaxoSmithKline?
So what happened was that, you know, you're working in a laboratory, you're doing research that's pretty basic. I mean, I was looking at genes regulating gastric acid secretion, cloning receptors on parietal cells, that these receptors that controlled acid secretion and so forth. And somehow you felt like this work was going to actually have an impact on patients somewhere down the line. But you're never sure, and you're pretty distant from any direct effect on patients. So, and I always wanted to have an impact on patients' lives. That was the principal driver for me and whatever I did. And so the first thing that I realized was that I had written a book chapter for a textbook of gastroenterology. This is the Schlesinger and Fortran textbook. And more people knew about that chapter than any other research that I'd done. And then I realized that actually, you know, educating people is really important. You can have an impact on a great number of people's lives if you can educate people and you know, do things like textbooks or be engaged in educating house officers and medical students. And it was the first time I thought I'd want to become a chairman of medicine, because there you could have an impact on lots and lots of residents who would then go out and have an impact on lots of patients' lives. And I loved that aspect of being a chairman of medicine, of daily contact with house officers, of making chief rounds and morning report every morning. You know, just knowing that through your knowledge, your clinical judgment, and through serving as a role model, you can influence a lot of people's lives. Similarly, writing a textbook, I thought, would have a broader impact than, you know, whatever research I was doing. So, you know, I got engaged and edited a textbook of gastroenterology. But then I got a call from a headhunter and said they were looking for a member of the board of directors of SmithKline Beecham Pharmaceutical Company. And I knew SmithKline Beecham because they made Tagamet, which is a revolutionary medicine. And when I went to SmithKline Beecham as a board member, I realized that these people were really serious in a very difficult task. Making medicines is maybe the hardest task in biomedical science. I used to think basic research was tough. I mean, when you actually have to make a medicine, so many things can go wrong. The process is so complicated and difficult. The intellectual challenge of it was amazing to me. And then, of course, if you were able and successful in making a drug, and know that that drug had an impact on so many people's lives, well, that sold me on the industry. And when they asked me, after a couple of years on the board, they asked me if I'd join the company, I didn't think twice about it. I thought I could stay close to the science. I could really be engaged in a really noble endeavor of making medicines and hopefully having impact on millions of people's lives. That was an offer I couldn't refuse. And it seemed better than being a dean, to tell you the truth. And this is no offense meant to any deans, I have to say. But I was actually delighted to do that.
Now, while you were at the helm of GSK, you oversaw a near doubling of the number of drugs in the GSK pipeline from 50 to 97. How do you go about engineering something quite so enormous?
Well, I was very fortunate, I think, because I hadn't come from an industry background. So I could look at how people were doing things with a very fresh eye. And what I saw is a pattern that often happens in companies. Companies start out very small. Everybody knows everybody else. Everybody works together. They're creative, excited, engaged. There's a sense of urgency about what's going on. Then you get a blockbuster and you become successful. And then all of a sudden, you impose bureaucracy. Bureaucracy here, bureaucracy there. You're spending millions and billions of dollars you've got to make sure is being spent properly and so on. So what happens is you stifle innovation. You stifle the scientists that are driving, you know, the real new products. And that, I think, is what is death to a pharma company. And so the only thing I did was, first of all, I took this big operation and divided it up into smaller units. And secondly, I gave those smaller units authority and accountability. And thirdly, I removed as much bureaucracy as I could. And I couldn't remove all of it, but by leaving the decisions down to the lowest possible place where they could be made, I think we got a huge amount of productivity out of it.
So after all those years at GSK and doubling the pipeline and experiencing an enormous amount of success with GSK, how did you make the decision to leave for a completely different group of problems like the Gates Foundation?
Well, as I said before, my focus has always been on patient impact. And when I was at GSK, shortly after the Glaxo and SmithKline merger, I came from the SmithKline side. We didn't have HIV medicines. Glaxo had HIV medicines. After the merger, the new company was a big player in HIV. And in 2000, the new company, GlaxoSmithKline, sued Nelson Mandela and the government of South Africa over the pricing of HIV medicine. That shocked me. It embarrassed me, made me wonder what I was doing in a company. I went to the board of directors and I said, I don't think this is the right thing, and that we should actually be making medicines for people who need them. So they said, what would you do? And I said, well, let me set up a laboratory that just focuses on malaria and TB, and we'll make medicines there and we won't worry about whether we make money or not. You know, I'll make a limited investment in this and I'll ask the team to be entrepreneurial about raising more money. So the team was a very good team. They got started and then they raised money from collaborations with what were called product development partnerships, Medicines for Malaria Venture, the Global Alliance for TB. And these were groups that were largely funded by the Gates Foundation.
Even though it was through GSK, it was still funded.
Well, actually, the Medicines for Malaria Venture is like a biotech startup company that focuses on malaria. And they're partnering with big pharma companies and with academia, sort of like a conduit between intellectual property, biotech, and big pharma companies in the space of malaria. And we were partnering with them. And We developed a very strong collaboration, and also with the Global Alliance for TB similarly. Well, after a couple of years, I decided I'd go to the Gates Foundation to talk about what we were doing. And when I went, I'll never forget, the CEO of the foundation, at the end of our discussion, said, can I see you in the office? I said, fine. I went into the office. She says, you know, we're wondering if you'd come here and run our health program. I thought, oh my goodness, I'd never thought about it, but what an amazing opportunity. And about a month later, I met with Bill and Melinda, and they really inspired me. And so, again, I didn't think twice about it, and I left the pharmaceutical world and joined the Gates Foundation. It's been one of the most amazing experiences of my life.
Now, what are you most proud about that you did during your time at the Gates Foundation? What initiatives did you begin?
Yeah, I think I think there are really four things that I felt that I feel like were things that I contributed to the foundation and to the world of global health, and initiatives that I carry with me now and what I'm doing. I think the first is creating a sense of urgency. Now, Bill had that sense of urgency. In a very short time with the foundation, I got that sense of urgency. I mean, you go out in the field and you see a mother hanging on to a baby that's dying, and you know that's occurring 8 million times, you know, a year unnecessarily, you get a real sense of urgency. And that sense of urgency I carry with me everywhere now in what I do. But I think we created a sense of urgency in the foundation and in the world of global health. A lot of people got uncomfortable with the idea that, well, there's so many, the problems are so big, there's nothing you can do about them. But we changed that. I think the Gates Foundation changed the way we looked at these problems and recognizing that we could actually do something about them. Then it was destructive to wait and to be slow about it. The second thing I think we did was we realized that the problems were so big that we really needed truly innovative approaches to these problems. And innovation is sometimes very hard because we have a process of peer review. Now, true innovators have no peers. Therefore, when you have peer review, you tend to destroy innovation. And also, innovation comes from anywhere in the world, and you got to somehow make it easy for that innovation to come forward. So we created a program called Grand Challenges Explorations, which was a program that was a two-page application, just a brilliant idea, and a way to test it. And the review process involved great innovators, but not peers. And it's fantastic what we got out of it. You got $100,000 within 3 months of the application. And if the application, if you could actually demonstrate progress, you got $1 million the next time around. And some of these ideas were just fantastic. You know, everything from some great science from Nobel Prize winners. By the way, the application process was completely anonymous, so you didn't know whether your grant came from a graduate student or a Nobel Prize winner. It turns out, you know, some of them were very brilliant Nobel Prize winner types, and some of them were graduate students. And we had things like in the original Grand Challenges programs, you know, developing so-called confusants, which would act on odorant receptors of mosquitoes so that they couldn't recognize human beings as food, and therefore they were confused. And so the new class of agents were called confusants. Ideas where you take people and pass them through an airline security frame, microwave radiation would cause the hemozoan pigment inside a parasite to vibrate, and the vibration set up a process of apoptosis, programmed cell death, to creating an electrical field between two telephone poles, recognizing a mosquito that crossed it, and then zapping it with a laser gun. I mean, you know, incredible ideas. Some of them seem wild and crazy, but that's where true innovation is going to come from. A third thing that I think we did was we really focused a lot on measurement. It's easy to, when you think you're doing something that's for the greater good, that you're actually accomplishing something, but that's not the case. There's so much goodwill out there and so much money being poured into ineffective programs that have no impact. So we really focused a lot on measurement, measuring impact, creating vehicles for this, setting up an institute for health metrics and evaluation, a health metrics network, collaborating with the International Initiative for Impact Evaluation and so on, and really trying to get a handle on whether we were moving the needle or not. And then, and lastly, I would say partnership. You know, there's an old African adage that if you want to go fast, travel alone. If you want to go far, travel together. And in the world of global health, there are lots of players. There's the WHO, UNICEF, Global Fund, Gavi, and so forth. And how we create a collaborative network to accomplish common goal is something that I think the Gates Foundation tried to do, and that's had a very positive impact. So I would say those are the four critical initiatives that I was part of in my tenure at the Gates Foundation.
Now you speak with such excitement and passion about the things that you did there. So what motivated you then to leave that sort of a role to go back into the pharmaceutical world in your new role as CMSO and Executive Right. Vice President at Takeda?
Well, first of all, when I went to the foundation, I promised Bill and Melinda that I would put 5 years with them, and I did. 5 years and 7 days, I think. So I really gave myself 5 years. And part of the reason why is when I left Japan at 15 to come to the U.S., I made my father promise that one day I'd come back to Japan and do something in Japan. And it was something that was always in the back of my mind, but the events of March of 2011, where there was a terrible earthquake and tsunami and nuclear holocaust, and you know, it seemed like Japan was really down, and I felt a sense of urgency about doing something, helping in some way. And I also felt that what I learned at the foundation about urgency, innovation, measuring, partnering, these things would help the pharmaceutical industry too. I actually believe the pharmaceutical industry is the most important industry in the world. And you know, it may not sound objective, but there is no more cost-effective solution for health problems than a pill or a vaccine. You take polio vaccine, the average price for a polio vaccine today is 12 cents. This is, you know, purchased through UNICEF. And the impact that vaccine has had, or measles vaccine for a nickel, these are created by the pharmaceutical industry. And the medicines that have transformed HIV in Africa and elsewhere in the world, these are made in the pharmaceutical industry. And in the end, working in the foundation, I realized even more how important the pharmaceutical industry is, and how I think it's a little bit beleaguered as an industry, in the same way Japan is a little bit beleaguered by the events. I felt that this is where I can make an impact, and at the same time live up to a promise I made to my father many years ago.
Do you think things work differently in Japan than what you were used to in terms of running companies in the United States?
Yes. Japanese people are very different in many ways than Americans. It's interesting because I spent the vast majority of my life in the United States and in Europe. And I had come to thinking that I was an American, and I am, of course, but when I went back to Takeda, I realized there's a lot more of me that was Japanese than I realized, and many of the ways I think and the values I have and so forth are driven by having been born and brought up in Japan, and I didn't recognize it until I went back. And it's been fun. The company that I work for is actually very international. It's now the 10th largest pharmaceutical company in the world. 70% of its employees are non-Japanese. So it's not exactly a Japanese company anymore. It's an international company. And it's been exciting to watch its transformation and to be part of it and to be making medicines again, medicines and vaccines.
What advice would you give to trainees that would want to follow a little of your path towards a career, not necessarily entirely in academic medicine, but would you encourage people to go into the pharmaceutical industry as physician scientists?
Well, you know, I think being a physician is a tremendously liberating event. Most people, on one hand, you could say, oh, now I'm sort of tied to patients for the rest of my life, and you are. There's no question patients come first in your life. If you're a physician, that's always in the back of your mind. But it's liberating in the sense that you can do anything. You can be a great clinician, you can be an academician doing clinical work or teaching or doing science. You can be an administrator, you can work in government, you can work in industry, you can work in philanthropy. There's no limit to what you can do. And I think there are two ways to do these kinds of things. I'm really humbled that you've asked me to do this, because I know the other people that you've interviewed, and I'm awed by their accomplishments. And they've done things one way, a different way, which is really a single-minded focus that they've placed on their work, and I admire them for that. In my case, I found it tremendously invigorating and exciting to do different things at different phases in my career. And I'm not saying that that's the best way, but it certainly is a fun way to be a physician and to learn that you can contribute to patient welfare in many, many different ways. And with the different things that I've done in my life, I feel like I can bring a slightly different perspective to my work as a physician, as a scientist, as a business executive.
Now, speaking of the business side of things, do you think that's a critical part of the training that MDs and scientists in general don't really have a grasp on? How were you able to learn that aspect of your work?
I was very fortunate. When I joined SmithKline Beecham, they decided to train me in business before I became head of R&D. So for 3 years, I ran a commercial sector of the company. Now, it turned out to be a somewhat less important part of the company, because SmithKline Beecham is a pharmaceutical company, but it also had a clinical laboratory, and it had a pharmacy benefit management company, PBM. And they asked me to run those two businesses. It was, you know, several billion dollars of revenue and 15,000 people. And they put me in charge, and I didn't know very much. And I had a great CFO who taught me. He gave me business 101. And over the course of 3 years, I learned actually how businesses run and how to work inside a commercial environment. It was very fascinating, exciting for me. And when to succeed in the pharmaceutical world, I think you have to combine a knowledge of medicine, of science, and business, all three. Any one to the exclusion of the other two, or any two to the exclusion of any one, will result in bad decision making. And in the end, the pharmaceutical industry is not broken. What breaks companies in the industry? Bad decision making.
It's interesting to hear your perspective on this. Do you have an opinion about the way that healthcare reform is changing in the United States?
Yeah, I'm very worried about healthcare reform without changing what I think the fee-for-service system does in healthcare. Ultimately, every new patient added to the health system increases cost. Every new physician added to the health system increases cost. So unless you address the issue of fee-for-service, all the additional access, all the additional health care, all the additional physicians being added to the system are just increasing costs, and it's not sustainable. The current cost of medicine in the United States is 16-17% of GDP. If it keeps going up, we're just going to be working to pay our medical bills. So something has to be done about the fee-for-service system. So when you talk about healthcare reform, we often think about it just in terms of access. But I think the financing and the incentive systems in healthcare have to change. And we have a fundamental conflict. I'm a gastroenterologist. I see a patient. If I do a colonoscopy on the patient, I get paid. I have a conflict of interest. I'm making a decision that will ensure that I make money. And of course you say you're going to do this in the best interest of the patient, but in any other world it would say that's a conflict of interest. And we're faced with that every day. Now I'm getting into politics, and I probably shouldn't do that because I don't know much about politics.
What would you do if you were not a scientist or physician?
Well, I was very interested in history, and I was interested in history and government and that sort of thing, and I thought I'd be a graduate student. I also, when I was much younger, I used to paint a lot, and I thought I might want to be an artist, but medicine is such a rich and full life that I can't imagine anything else right now. And I don't think I'll ever stop being a physician.
Well, I really appreciate your insights into a completely different sort of a path in medicine, and I really appreciate that you took the time to talk to us.
Thank you very much. It's very nice to see you.